All right. If there is one thing that solves ringing and vibrations, there should be it, right? Well, no, actually. Turns out that getting rid of ringing artifacts is a bit more complex than it seems at first. But good news, I tried a couple different solutions, and the one that performed the best was also the simplest one. It wasn't this one. I tried four different setups, including bolting a concrete paver straight to the printer, and I want to share the results with you, and I think I can even explain what is happening in each one too. And I can also explain today's sponsor, private internet access. Look, there are plenty of VPN services around, but this is the one that I actually personally use. A while ago, I compared VPN providers, and private internet access ended up being the one that checked all the boxes for features like port forwarding, a no-log policy, and fast service without throttling or filtering, while also being one of the most affordable options. The client is open source, but you can use any of your own OpenVPN or WireGuard compatible clients as well. Private internet access has service in over 75 countries, so when I want to experience the internet from the great country of Kazakhstan, I can. Also works with any of your favorite streaming services. You can use a single private internet access subscription with up to 10 different devices at the same time. And when you sign up for the 2-year plan, it comes out to just over $2 a month or just under €2 a month. Plus, if you use this link, also down in the description below, you get an extra 3 months for free. You don't get those if you don't use the link. They have 24/7 live chat support and you can try them risk-free with their 30-day money-back guarantee. Thanks again to Private Internet Access for sponsoring this video. Okay, so for these tests, I thought I'd use one of the machines I don't usually grab. So I got this Diality Ender 3v2 out of storage. This thing is 100% stock, just as I like my printers. It did need a bit of adjustment on the wheels on each of the axes to take out the slop, and I also double-checked belt tension on X and Y, and it was ready for some test prints to establish a baseline of what the printer does, you know, stock, without any help. Thankfully, Prusa Slicer has a profile built in for the Ender 3v2, so I used that to slice. Of course, a 3D Benchy, then a more organic shape in the form of Prusa's buddy, as well as CNC Kitchen's ringing test part, printed in vase mode because we really don't care about any of the stuff inside the prints at this point. For filament, I'm using the Prusa Mint Mystic Green PLA because with that shimmer effect, that really tends to highlight any imperfections in parts, especially ringing. So one thing immediately becomes clear when printing on the Ender 3v2, we're not going to see much of an improvement in how well printer vibrations will end up getting transferred to your desk and cause structure-borne noise here. There simply isn't much in the terms of vibrations to start with, thanks to the Trinamic or Trinamic clone drivers this machine is using, but also the fans on here simply drown out any vibrations that might actually be there. Also though, there wasn't much in ringing on the parts to start with, so I mean that's great for the printer, but it also doesn't give us much to improve on. Easy solution: cranking up the speeds, accelerations, and junction deviation limits, and I actually had to up them in the slicer and on the machine too. Typically, the machine limits are set rather high and you can work within those limits by adjusting stuff in the slicer, not on the Ender 3v2. Here, the defaults are quite low and your adjustment range, without recompiling the firmware, is chosen so that the printer can just barely keep up when you crank them to the max. So that's good. That's reasonable limits that give us more print speed, more ringing, but also is just slow enough to not completely ruin the parts with skipped steps. So here's what we got. Ringing, just as the doctor ordered. So everywhere where there's a sharp corner, you see replicas of that corner shape along the direction of the printer travel. This is sometimes also called ghosting because you'll see ghosts of those features along the part. It's most clearly visible on the bullseye at the front of the Benchy. It looks like it's happening at two different frequencies at different heights, but this is because for this area here, where it's only doing small continuous loops for a perimeter, the printer is actually slowing down to the small perimeter speed. So the printer's mechanics are still vibrating at those same frequencies. It's just that those vibrations are being plotted at a different rate. There's also a different artifact on here that looks like ringing, but it's actually an entirely different thing. And that's these lines, very hard to see, that are parallel to each of the printer's axes. These are tree ringing or salmon skin effect, and it's caused usually by the stepper motors themselves snapping into certain positions. So none of what we're doing today is going to have any effect on that. Okay, test number one, anti-vibration feet. These are typically used to isolate the printer's frame from the surface it sits on, but these can also help to reduce ringing. So I printed off four pieces in vase mode on the Mark III that has the Quinley auto eject system installed, which worked really well. So get subscribed if you don't want to miss the review of that. But these feet are by Schützi 99 and they're not designed specifically for this machine, but they'll clip into anything, you know, that uses a standard extrusion profile. And these made for a surprisingly wobbly printer. And after two of the prints, they had sagged enough that some of the printer's wiring was starting to make contact with the table. But they still seem to work pretty well if we look at the printed parts we got. There's just a significant improvement in how long the printer keeps resonating after it hits a sharp corner. With these new feet, it pretty much dies down within 2 or 3 cycles or so, while the default rubber block feet, you know, with those, it looks like it's probably keeping on ringing for probably a dozen cycles. It's really hard to see, but it also looks like the frequency on the ringing is ever so slightly higher than with the default feet. And I know it doesn't look like it, but I swear this is the exact same G-code at the exact same settings. Literally, you know, printed back to back. What's also interesting is that the layer skip on the Benchy is gone, at least the one in the lower half. So that's another indicator that yes, these feet really seem to dampen the oscillations in the printer. But okay, since suspending the printer on these wobbly feet seems to have improved things, let's try suspending it completely. So I grabbed some elastic tie-downs and tried to suspend the printer from the gallery in here, and well, turns out that these are a lot more elastic than I was hoping for. So I replaced the majority of that with a ratchet strap and doubled up the elastic rope where it's attached to the printer. And now we have a machine that can swing around completely freely, and it even has some up and down elasticity. So this should be amazing for isolating vibrations from your building, but will it also work for reducing ringing within the printer? Well, no, not really. It does look super cool while it's printing, with the entire thing shifting around as it changes its center of gravity. But the prints look identical to the ones done with the stock feet. If anything, the CNC kitchen test print looks a bit worse than the one with nothing done to the printer at all. Huh, okay. So if reducing the constraints on the printer frame didn't help, maybe we can go the other way and increase constraints. A weapon of choice for that? Concrete. Well, we're not going to pour any, but I've got a couple of these concrete pavers that I can attach to the printer base pretty easily. I could use fancy brackets, but since I don't care about this printer too much, the most straightforward thing to do is just to drill through the frame, drill into the paver, and add some spacers so that we don't clamp down onto the printer's wiring, and we can screw everything together. It's definitely a chonky boy now. For good measure, I also added the original printer feet onto the base of the paver, and we're ready to print another set. And well, it's not much. The prints look ever so slightly better. It looks like this setup killed the resonance that caused the layer shift at the top of the Benchy. And the test piece shows that at least the y-axis did profit from the extra weight attached, but it's not nearly as good as with the simple anti-vibration feet. So what's happening here? Well, let me start by explaining what these resonances are that we're seeing here. They wouldn't be a problem if our machine was infinitely rigid or built infinitely light, but in the real world, we have things like, you know, stretchy belts, brackets and aluminum parts that all have some amount of flex to them, and even the rotational axis on a stepper motor, as it turns, it has a certain elasticity to it. Also, of course, all these parts have some weight in the real world too. So let's say we're referencing the printer frame as our base. What both the X and the Y axes are basically weight on a string. We've built a mechanical oscillator. We can give it some motion input, but the harsher the input is, the more we're going to excite the system, which is while lower accelerations on a 3D printer will always lead to prints that have less ringing. Now, because in this demo I'm using a steel spring here, this is going to oscillate for a good while before it calms down. A 3D printer's belt is closer to something like the elastic ropes, and if we use one of those, we can see that it calms down much more quickly. Not instantaneously, but definitely reasonably fast. And that is because these have damping to them. Damping essentially takes energy out of the system and turns it into heat. And we can kind of see that if we simulate some oscillations on these printed feet. This is what you want. When we use a dampening element like this in the printer, we're essentially burning off the oscillations that cause ringing into a bit of heat in whatever is our damper. That might actually be why these feet sagged so quickly. They were just doing their job and, you know, they're just printed from PLA, so if that gets hot, it deforms. It's also why suspending the printer or bolting it down to concrete didn't change much about how the printer resonated, because neither being able to swing around completely freely, nor that rigid block of concrete did much to remove any of the energy of those oscillations. CNC folks know about this and fill the machine frames with sand, which apparently dampens extremely well. Of course, they're less worried about ringing on a motion axis, but are instead fighting vibrations from the cutting head that generates those directly. But at the end of the day, it's the exact same challenge. So should we fill our 3D printer frames with sand too? Maybe. I mean, it's not the worst idea I've ever heard of. As long as weight can be kept off of, you know, moving parts, it might actually work pretty well. Let me know in the comments if that's something you'd like me to see try out. Also, the rubber ropes, I think those could work, but not with it just suspended down from the ceiling, but maybe with a printer strapped into it, like a 4D cube looking thing. I briefly saw that somewhere, but I can't find where exactly it was now, but definitely something to try out. But yeah, the humble vibration dampening feet come out as the victor. I honestly never thought much of these, but they seem to work really well, both for reducing ringing and for reducing how much your table ends up vibrating too. Just maybe don't use these with printers that don't have a rigid base, like the Mark II Prusas. That can cause more issues than it solves. In either case, I hope this was interesting for you. It definitely was for me. Subscribe for more, support the channel on Patreon or through YouTube memberships to make it all possible for me. Thank you all for watching, keep on making, and I will see you all in the next one. Bye.